this is the Kanimbla Valley, we were looking for a place in the country to build a sort of a weekend, or get away from the city, you know. And so when we acquired this land, we had to name it, of course. We're in the habit of naming things.
But because it was Lot 19, it triggered something.
Yes, it triggered something because in the Lord of the Rings, Bilbo and Frodo lived in Hobbiton, but they lived in 19 Bagshot Row. And so we named the track that we put in towards the little cabin that we built Bagshot Row, and this was 19 Bagshot Row. And then, of course, the whole place was Middle Earth. And my son at the time was probably 8, maybe 9, and he painted a little sign, Middle Earth, which actually is still the original sign on our gate now. There's a river that goes through here, that's the Cox's River, which runs into the Warragamba Dam, and that was a big attraction for us as well. And so that's what we did. We bought the land and we built a little cabin on it, and we came here on weekends.
It was cattle and sheep grazing country beforehand. And the people who came here to farm were from Europe. And so they brought European ways with them. And so they cleared the land and it baked. I think CSIRO did a study and they found that 30%, around about 30% of tree cover on the land is good because it keeps the earth cool, it allows the grass to grow, and it gives the cattle respite in the harsh sun.
And because it had been a sheep farm, it had been denuded of trees. There were lots of trees that had been cut down, others had been ringbarked. And so we set about to reforest it, basically. We took several years to do that, but it was fun doing it. I think at last count, I thought it was over 3,000 trees that we planted. The last major planting was down near the river, where we put in 600 new trees.
I often go past the very, very first tree that we ever planted here, which is a Tasmanian blue gum, and it's a majestic tree now.
And then, of course, we wanted to build something, and I wanted to have something that was sort of eco-friendly and it would blend in with the landscape and that sort of thing. So we decided to do something underground. I'd heard about underground houses, and basically what it meant is we went to a steep part of one of the hills that's sort of the central hill in the land, and we had a very large hole dug because it's a two-storey place. And a very large hole excavated by someone who had excavators down the end of the road here. He does earthworks. He spent 6 weeks digging this hole, putting the topsoil on one side and the subsoil somewhere else. And then we started building. And that soil was then used to go back to backfill and to go over the top as well. So there's about a meter and a half of dirt sitting on top of the roof, which is, of course, concrete. And That did require a lot of waterproofing. You know, when you go underground, you've got to make sure that that damp doesn't get in. Now, this is not a very wet area. The rainfall here is lower than say in Katoomba or in Lithgow. This is basically in a rain shadow area, but it does rain heavily at times. And this last year, when we had a very wet year, the water actually oozed out of the side of the hill and caused some landslides here. But the house stayed dry. So we did do an overkill, but it was worth it because it worked. And you can't have a second bite at that cherry. You know, if you had a dam problem, you would have to dig in down so far, it would be almost impossible. So it was essential to do an overkill, and it's worked really well. I wanted to be self-sufficient, or at least try to see if you could be self-sufficient. And that really meant sort of not connecting to the grid and doing your own water and hopefully growing at least part of your own food. Just to see, because it's fun doing it, but it, more than just the fun, it was a sort of the thing, could you do this, you know? And it can be done, you know, it can be done. And you don't have to do too many compromises, but you do have to make some. It being largely underground helps a lot, because it gets quite cold here in winter, and if you leave a dish of water outside, it will freeze, you know? So it obviously drops to minus a few degrees at least, maybe minus 10, I don't know. But inside the house, it's always relatively comfortable. We do top it up with, we have an open fire, a wood burning fire, and that heats this whole place really. Because I had measured temperatures in test holes, where I'd monitored the temperatures for a while, and we found that down, if you go down sort of behind this wall, if you like, the temperature never varies much from 14 degrees, summer and winter. So I'm not fighting against minus 10, I'm only fighting against 14, and that makes it a lot easier. Energy is photovoltaic, solar, and then batteries. And the batteries are a bit unique. They're different to what most people have for batteries. Most of the off-grid systems use lithium batteries, and they're good. They have lots of advantages. They have some disadvantages too, in the sense that one of them is that they have a finite life. They're usually about 10 years or 1,000 cycles. And they're expensive. My battery bank is a low voltage bank. The lithium batteries usually are connected in series to about 400 volts, which has some advantages because if you're working at higher voltages, you can keep your wires smaller. My battery bank is only 24 volts, and that means the cables have to be much thicker. But they're based on a battery which is a nickel iron chemistry, and this was a battery that was actually invented in Sweden around about 1850 or something. And around the turn of the century, the 20th century, Edison got onto these, because Edison was a tinkerer and an inventor, but one of the things he did around 1900 was to make electric cars. And he made electric cars. Now they had a run on something, and he used nickel iron batteries, which he manufactured himself. So he had a complete, he made the batteries, he made the cars. And the interesting thing is, the batteries that he made, and there's batteries that he made in 1905, which are still working. So they have a long life cycle. They're almost indestructible. They last 120 years at least, that we know of. And that's one of the big advantages of those batteries, but there are some disadvantages as well. So, you know, you get the good with the bad, but overall I wanted something that had a long lifetime. And so I got the nickel. The shutters have several applications, I suppose. One of them, of course, is against fire, you know, and really bad weather, perhaps. But it's also part of our temperature control. In winter, we close them at night, and we close the curtains as well, and that provides a nice buffer in there. And then we open it during the day to let the warmth in. In summer, we do the opposite. We leave them open at night in order to help get rid of any heat that we've absorbed. And that works out really well. And if we're away, it provides some security as well. You know, I'm a physicist, and I was at the time working at the University of New South Wales, where I was a professor of physics. Later, I moved to Sydney University, but that wasn't until 2004 or so. And the house was well and truly on its way by then. So physics did provide me with the right background, because it meant that I could design things, I could do calculations on heat losses and so on, you know, and that went right into the planning, right from the start. So then started from scratch, you know, sort of drawing things, and in the end designed this in a computer CAD package. Which then allows you to play with different scenarios and different looks and so on before you actually build it, you know. And I think that really was very important, because we could you could say, no, I don't like that, no, we'll shift this or move that. And you can do that in the CAD package without much effort. Most of it we did ourselves. The stairs, for instance, are quite interesting because my daughter was working in Denmark at the time, and we were exchanging plans over by email. And she had researched something that the Greeks knew about stairs. And the Greeks worked out that there is an ideal rise to step ratio. And it's quite a narrow range that is ideal. So we said, okay, well, we'll follow that. But then you've got to get up a certain distance, and you know, you can't do it in one, you could do it in one long stairs, but that's not so good. So we decided to wrap it around the pillar, but then you've got to make sure that you don't hit your head, you know, when you get to the platform and so on. So there were lots of constraints, but we built it according to that, and then put that all into the CAD package, and then it was just a matter of constructing it. Now, that took some time. That's often referred to as a vacuum lift. It actually works by partially evacuating a cabin in the tube above the lift, and then air pressure pushes the cabin up. It's neat because it doesn't require any cables, it's very safe because it can't actually drop down. If everything else fails, it just cannot go down very fast because it's going to push the air out. The original design called for three large skylights, but long before we got there, someone put us onto the fact that there's lots of glass to be had for free, because the buildings in the city are constantly being renovated, and when they renovate, they tend to renovate a whole floor, and most of the floors have glass partitions. And most of the floors are 2.7 meters high, and all the glass is 2.7 meters high, but different widths. When they renovate the floor, the contract to demolish it goes to one contractor, and the contract to rebuild whatever partitions they now need goes to another contractor. Well, the demolition guy has to get rid of that glass, and it's very hard to get it down, so they generally crush it. Which is a terrible shame because the glass is, you know, 10.4 millimeter glass. It's laminated glass, and it's such a waste. And so basically, he said, it's for free. You take it away, but you can't take just a couple of pieces. You have got to take a whole floor. And so we hired a truck and a couple of extra people to help us carry this stuff and to take it down. And we. Each floor is sort of about 30 or 40 pieces of glass. And then the next weekend, we get a call from him saying, would you like another floor? I thought, oh yeah, we'll take another floor. And so we ended up taking about six or seven floors of glass over a period of several months. And we had a huge stockpile of this glass. So we then looked at our plans and said, look, three little skylights is ridiculous, but we've got this whole pile of glass, you know? So we changed the design and put the girders up there and put the glass in and all the glass in the front, you know, all those and upstairs, even internal, all that glass came from there. Toilet that is a composting toilet, and the reason for doing that was to save water, because you know your toilet can take up to 80% of the water you use, and so having a composting toilet which doesn't use any water at all was really good. But again, there there is a bit of work involved. You've got to take some of the compost out. Probably we'd probably do it every year. If you had more people living in the house, you probably have to do it more frequently. You put a bit of sawdust down to keep it fluffy, and the bacteria seem to like that. And you need an airflow. You need to keep it dry. So there's a fan that runs 24 hours a day that sucks air down the toilets and then up over the compost and then up through a chimney. We have a veggie patch and a greenhouse, so Tillie grows stuff. At the moment, she's growing vegetables right now, but she's actually devoted some parts of it to growing other plants, so trees. Most of the trees now are from seeds that she's collected.
It's a learning experience. It's a long journey, but it's incredibly rewarding. Both the house and then just rehabilitating the land all around. Just watching things grow. It's quite devastating when the droughts are on and everything just goes brown and looks so tired. And then you get the rains and it looks like this. And then it's beautiful.
So it's also just nice to be self-sufficient. You know, we take the water from the river and we purify it, and that supplies the house. And we have solar panels that charge up our batteries and inverters that feed the house. And our cooking is electric. I have an electric car, and it gets charged from that too. So you know, it's really being self-sufficient, and it's a good feeling. Thank you.